years on television. Now sit back and enjoy the show selected especially for public television.
Hello, I'm Mary Lou Metzger. Welcome to the Lawrence Welk Show. The program you're about to see, Broadway Musicals, was taped in 1971. On this show, we'll experience the Sound of Music epic featuring the Lawrence Welk Orchestra. Myron Florin plays his accordion with a little bit of luck and a very inspirational song, You'll Never Walk Alone, sung by the beautiful champagne lady, Norma Zimmer. In fact, following this show, I have a very special visit with Norma Zimmer, who provides us all with inspirational stories and what it's like to be the Lawrence Welk Champagne Lady. So stay with us. And now, here's the maestro himself, Lawrence Welk.
From Hollywood, the Lawrence Welk Network presents The Lawrence Welk Show, and tonight it's Champagne on Broadway.
Sandy, great. Let's give him a great big hand. Excellent, fellas. The songs you just heard were all from the great show, The Sound of Music. And this evening, we're going to be playing and singing songs from several Broadway musicals. We realize not all of you people get a chance to see a Broadway show in person, but I assure you the songs are familiar to everyone. Here's an example, a song from My Fair Lady by Ken Dillo. Come in, Ken.
Thank you, Lawrence. I've grown accustomed to her face. She almost makes the day begin. I've grown accustomed to the tune she whistles night and noon. Her smiles, her frowns, her ups, her downs are second nature to me now. Like breathing out and breathing in, I was serenely independent and content before we met. Surely I could always be that way again, and yet I've grown accustomed to her looks, accustomed to her voice, accustomed to her face. She's second nature to me now, like breathing out and breathing in. I'm very grateful she's a woman and so easy to forget. Rather like a habit one can always break, and yet I've grown accustomed to the trace of something in the air. Accustomed to her face.
Thank you. Thank you, fellas. Thank you very much. Bobby and Cissy have picked a song from a 1931 show called The Bandwagon. The tune is titled Dancing in the Dark. Now, that was a little early, before my time, but seeing as it was the years of the Depression, I don't know the circumstances, but maybe the songwriter was inspired because he couldn't pay his light bill. But fortunately for us, we have plenty of lights to catch all of Bobby's and Cissy's beautiful movements. So here are Bobby and Cissy dancing in full lights, but still dancing in the dark. You folks understand it. Explain to the folks who don't.
Thank you.
Now, ladies, one of your favorites, Jimmy Roberts.
My romance doesn't have to have a moon in the sky. My romance doesn't need a blue lagoon standing by. No month of May, no twinkling stars, no hideaway, no soft guitars. My romance doesn't need a castle rising in Spain, nor a dance to a constantly surprising refrain. Wide awake, I can make my most fantastic dreams come true. My romance doesn't need a thing but you.
Now I see Myron Florence getting his little polka band together for a song from My Fair Lady. It's titled With a Little Bit of Luck, which isn't exactly appropriate in Myron's case. This happy Norwegian became a great accordionist, not with a little bit of luck, but with a constant practice. Myron, come in, please.
Thank you for that wonderful introduction. And fellas, did you see how we turned down the dancers out there? Isn't that something? Now let's listen in on a domestic scene involving a popular couple who are not only talented, but obviously very much in love. Guy and Ron.
Don't throw bouquets at me. Don't please my folks too much. Don't laugh at my jokes too much. People will say we're in love.
When it comes to pleasant listening, it's pretty hard to beat our wonderful string section. Listen to this pretty song from Carousel, If I Loved You. Wasn't that nice? Very relaxing. Thank you, Charlotte and boys. Sandy and Sally have been making a big hit on our show for the past 4 years. The words in this song help to explain their success.
Sally, read this. Two clowns wanted for a Broadway show. My goodness, that's what we've been waiting for.
Gray skies are gonna clear up. Put on a happy face. Brush off the clouds and cheer up. Put on a happy face. Take off that gloomy mask of tragedy. It's not your style. You'll look so good that you'll be glad you decided to smile. Pick out a pleasant outlook. Stick out that noble chin. Wipe off that full of doubt look. Slap on a happy grin. And spread sunshine. Got a pleasant outlook, stick out that noble chin, wipe off that full of doubt look, slap on a happy grin, and spread sunshine all over the place. Just put on a happy face.
Yes, it always helps to put on a happy face, no matter how you do it. At the beginning of our show, I heard our announcer, Bob Warren, say, this evening we're bringing you champagne on Broadway. Here's a sample, a Broadway show tune in champagne style, getting to know you from The King and I.
Thank you.
Typical champagne music. We hope you all enjoyed it. A Broadway show with an Irish setting sounds like a natural for Joe Feeney. Here's Joe with a song from Finian's Rainbow, Bob Rossman of the Celeste.
How are things in Glockamora? Is that little brook still leaping there? Does it still run down through Donegal, through Killybegs, Kilcarry, and Kildare? How are things in Glockamora? Is that willow tree still weeping there? Does that lassie with the twinkling eye come smiling by? And does she walk away sad and dreamy there, not to see me there? So I ask each weeping willow and each brook along the way, and each lass that comes a-sighing to relay.
Of Joe Feeney is awe-inspiring, especially when he sings How Are Things in Glockamora. Be sure to stay with us following the show for a fascinating visit with the beautiful champagne lady, Norma Zimmer. And now, back to the show.
Well, I know you have all been waiting for our lovely champagne lady, Norma Zimmer. Norma sings a beautiful song of faith that expresses her own philosophy. Norma, that song sounds like it could have been written for you or about you. Now, my friends, let me take you back to the band again, and the Champagne Music Makers are ready with a song by Rodgers and Hart. This Can't Be Love. Thank you. It always gives us a nice feeling to see talented young people make something out of themselves. We first heard Bob Ralston when he was just 15 years of age. Since then, he has come a long way developing his talent to a high degree of perfection and opening up many new opportunities for himself, including his own syndicated television show. Here's Bob with a sample of the music he plays on his show. Wasn't that beautiful? If ever I would leave you. Bob, I hope it never happens. You folks all know what a wonderful job Clay Hart does for us. Clay, please introduce your song.
Thank you, Lawrence. Tonight I'm going to do something a little different. I'm not going to sing a country song, which I love, but I'm going to do a big hit from off-Broadway from the show Fantastics, a very pretty song that Ed Ames made popular called Try to Remember. Remember the kind of September when life was slow, no, so mellow. Try to remember the kind of September when grass was green and grain was yellow. Try to remember the kind of September when you were a tender and callow fellow. Try to remember, and if you remember, then follow, 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 follow. Deep in December, it's nice to remember. Although you know the snow will follow, deep in December it's nice to remember. without a hurt. The heart is hollow. Deep in December, it's nice to remember the fire of September that made us mellow. Deep in December, your heart should remember and follow, 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 follow.
In this next segment of our show, we're going to take you back to the glamour days of Broadway. Every year, there was a new edition of the famous George White scandals. Let's join our people as they recall some of the songs from those great shows.
Good evening. I want to welcome all of you ladies and gentlemen here to the club tonight. Seeing as this is the blues era, let's find out how the blues really began as lovely Tanya sings Birth of the Blues.
They heard the breeze in the trees singing weird melodies, and they called them start of the blues. And from a jail came a wail of a down pushed it through hard till it was worn into a blue note. And then they loosed it, rehearsed it, and gave out the news that the Southland gave birth to the
Just great. Thank you, and thank you to Tanya. Boy, that beat is enough to make you want to dance. How about we all get together now and do that brand new dance craze, the Black Bottom?
Glad you've been able to join us for our salute to the Broadway musicals. Our special guest is a very special lady who graces any stage wherever she appears. Please welcome our beautiful champagne lady, Norma Zimmer.
Thank you, Mary Lou.
I'm so glad to have you here.
Thank you. It's a thrill to be here.
Last year, you gave every one of us a big scare when you had a heart attack right after you returned home from filming Precious Memories. What happened and how are you doing?
Oh, I'm just doing beautifully, thank you. I figured that it was a warning because I loved my cheese and butter and ice cream.
Me too.
And I've now discontinued those items in my diet. And I'm strictly, well, not strictly, but very much a vegetarian now. I don't eat a lot of red meat. I have lots of greenery. In fact, I make two of my meals, salads now, with all types of wonderful vegetables. And it makes me feel so much better. I'm glad that, actually, I'm kind of glad that that happened because it wasn't a serious heart attack. And it made me wake up to what I'm doing to my body.
A blessing in disguise.
That's right.
Norma, who discovered your musical talent?
Oh, you know, first of all, my dad. My father was a wonderful violin teacher. And he gave me violin lessons every day of my life for 10 years. And when I realized my hands were too small to really master the instrument, he had me try singing. And he said, well, you have a pretty voice. So he started me on vocalises and so forth. And then in high school, Carl Pitzer, our choir director, gave me leads in the school operas and so forth, operettas, and asked me to join his church choir. And actually, it was through his church choir that I began to have solos. And he thought, too, that my voice was very outstanding. And we had concerts every year. Our choir would put on these wonderful concerts. And one year, our guest soloist was Lee Sweetland, who had the summer replacement for the Lawrence Tibbett radio show. And he said, I had a solo there too, and he said, Norma, if you ever come to Hollywood, you look me and my wife up, we might be able to help you. So, and then my girlfriend gave me a trip to Victoria, B.C. on a lovely Princess Line, and on the way back from Victoria, we had a song fest on deck, and a lovely couple sat next to me, and the gentleman said, hold it, everybody, this little girl has a pretty voice. And they kept saying, more, more, more. I sang every song I knew. And that couple happened to be an Hollywood agents. And they said, if you ever get to Hollywood, look us up. So you see, I had so many wonderful opportunities.
So that's what brought you to
Hollywood? That's what got me to Hollywood.
I know you had a difficult childhood from reading your autobiography. There was alcoholism in your family and serious poverty.
Oh, yes.
How did you get through that without bitterness and anger?
You know, Mary Lou, I have seen other people who were bitter about something in their lives. It only hurt them. And I thought, my brother was bitter, too. And I thought, I'm not going to be bitter. I loved my parents. I understood that they were doing the best they knew how. And I thought, bitterness only hurts the one who's bitter. So I thought, get over it. You know? And just love them and accept them. But it was miserable when I grew up. I went hungry many times. And fortunately, we grew up in the Seattle area where there are a lot of natural foods. You go out digging for clams, crab, berries. And the blackberries just hang from the bushes up there.
You make it sound so wonderful.
Oh, well, it really is. It saved our lives, actually. And then I used to fish in the streams with a bent pin, and we'd catch trout, and Mom hated to clean them, but...
You also had a bit of a movie career.
Just a tiny one, a little bit part, but it was such fun. You know, I worked with Bing Crosby on his records and his radio show, and later some television, but he thought, too, that I had a pretty voice and said, why don't you do that little bit part in Mr. Music? So I did, got to sit at the edge of the stage with him and sing with him. It was a thrill.
Did you ever have a desire to pursue that?
No, I didn't. I was very happy with... I was a top soprano in a girls' quartet, and we did backup music for all the famous singing stars. And I was also thrilled to work with Nat King Cole and his original Nature Boy. I did the obligato. And Nelson Riddle was very instrumental in some of the things that I did. He used my voice as a flute. And our son Mark has saved some of those old recordings. It's such fun to look back on those wonderful days.
Oh,
because, you know, I started way before television. I worked with Fanny Bryce and the Baby Snooks, Al Jolson, Eddie Cantor, Jack Benny, Lucille Ball, Burns and Allen, all these marvelous, fabulous artists. And I never had a camera with me. I didn't take one picture with all those fabulous stars.
Do you have a favorite star?
Probably my favorite was Bing Crosby. He was so natural, so charming. He always whistled, and he'd stroll along pantomime with golf swings, you know. And we both came from Washington State, so we would have a contest to see who could remember the most Indian names. And Bing Crosby was the first fan letter that I got from him when I joined the Lawrence Welk Show.
Oh,
isn't that fun?
How wonderful. Uh-huh. You have another blessing in your life, a wonderful husband, Randy.
Oh, I can't say enough wonderful things.
How long have you been married?
Well, we've celebrated 61 years, but I'd like to share with you that for our 60th anniversary, we've had no snow in Utah, so we drove to California and skied on Mammoth Mountain for our 60th
anniversary. For your 60th anniversary? You skied on your 50th, too,
yes.
Didn't you?
Well, no, actually, our son Mark gave a beautiful garden party for our 50th, and we had 60 marvelous friends, some of our ski buddies there. It was beautiful. His home was gorgeous, and the garden was so lovely that your Linda real estate people, when he went to sell his home, said, "This is probably one of the most beautiful yards in Yorba Linda."
Oh, how beautiful. How did you become the champagne lady?
Well, actually, it was through my quartet work. We did backup for Lawrence on Yellow Bird and Calcutta.
Really?
And so forth. And one time he did an album for Thanksgiving, and I had a little four-bar solo. And he said, "My, you have it pretty. That's very pretty. Come and do it on my Thanksgiving show." So the day I arrived, I think the Lord was watching after me because Joe Feeney got laryngitis that day. So there was room for a solo. And Lawrence said, "Do you have an arrangement we can use?" Fortunately, I had just worked with Paul Weston and Joe Stafford at the Hollywood Bowl, and he had made a lovely arrangement of "Smoke Gets in Your Eyes." And so I called Vandy and said, "Honey, rush my arrangement of Smoke Gets in Your Eyes down to the studio." Now, he arrived maybe 10 minutes before airtime, and at that time, we were live.
Oh, boy.
Uh-huh. So we rehearsed it once, and I did it on the show. At that time, Lawrence had been without a girl singer for 2 years, and the switchboard lighted up, and people called in and said, "Why don't you make her your new singer?" So I was strictly an accident on the Lawrence Welk Show.
Oh, a blessed accident.
Well, I've been so privileged and so grateful to be a part of the show and to work with all of you. You're a family to me. I love you all. So
we feel the same way about you.
And now the OETA people are like family.
And our audience.
Yes, oh, praise the Lord.
What did you learn from Lawrence?
To love the audience. You know, he really loved the audience. He always carried little gifts to give them. And he stayed until the last person left after our concerts. He really, truly wanted to give the people what they wanted to hear. He had many secretaries who kept records of the requests. And he taught me to just appreciate the audience, appreciate the fans. And he was very generous, too. You know, Randy and I had built a lovely mobile home park. And he would say, "Norma, let me come and entertain your people." Out of the goodness of his heart, he would come out, maybe bring along Ken Dillo and Bobby and Barbara and Arthur Duncan, and dance with our ladies. They were thrilled, you can imagine. But he was so wonderful. I miss him terribly.
I do too. Mm-hmm. But we feel so blessed to have had time with you.
Thank you.
And also with you. You've been wonderful, and you are our family as well. So until next time, as Lawrence Welk always said, keep a song in your heart.
Good night, until we meet. Adios, au revoir, I'll be the same till then.
And though it's
dream.